Hackney Wick has been a forgotten part of East London until the beginning of this century, when an influx of creative types prized away from other areas understood the enormous potential of the Wick's warehouse spaces. Over the last two decades, an enormous amount of work transformed the area into a cultural hub of remarkable substance. You're looking at the birthplace of shellac and toilet paper. You might be forgiven for coming by and thinking, a few old warehouses, some graffiti, a few peculiar looking people, what's so special? What matters is what happens within the private practices and studios of the outstanding resident community, and how it happens. Because the Wick is not a postcode. It is a network of independent minds. The Wick is people.
Hackney Wick is like a unique place within a unique place in London. And Hackney has always been this amazing welcoming area for people of all backgrounds. And Hackney Wick is kind of like the edge. It's kind of the last bit. We've got the Olympic Park, which is all the new developments, shishi kind of developments and corporate art spaces and kind of gyms and strips of bars that are kind of in these retail barns. And on the left are the old industrial warehouses, which are still, some of them still industrial. And in this place, a lot of people, it's where the artist kind of finally ended up after being pushed out of every corner of East London. They've ended up here with the party goers, the organisers, the ravers, the musicians, the techno heads, the kind of wastes and strays. And it's an experiment, but it's an accidental experiment in kind of multicultural living that just came about by chance as a kind of desperate kind of measure.
A grand-scale residential development is destroying this valuable network. We seem to be trading cultural influence of the future for pocket money out of sales in residential developments. As if decision makers had lost a sense of duty and simply walk on, completely devoid of vision. Rundown industrial spaces have been repurposed by creative forces and have positively influenced the original neighborhoods by a confluence of skill, talent, and proactive networking, creating value, real value, through mutual support and proximity.
I mean, Hackney Wick has always been really important in the last decade, creatively, for London and in a lot of ways. But it still is, although obviously developers are carving it up right now. And I actually met one who gave me the honest truth, and he said that, the truth is that it's your job as artists and musicians to make places like this cost more. And that's where we come in, which was a refreshingly candid truth spoken by one of the, leading planners of Canary Wharf and someone who was in touch with the local planning people here. And he was also one of the original people who worked on plans that ended up becoming very controversial in this community. So how much has it changed? Obviously there's, still a thriving artistic community around here, and there's still a sense of genuine local community and a lot of like-minded people, and probably still an incredibly high density of artists, but half of Fish Island, for instance, is now been redeveloped to build these 5 or 6 story luxury apartments, and they're really selling it on the credentials of the artistic, bohemian, creative community. and, you know, the village-like aspects, but they're at the same time taking away from that. And they're calling it Fish Island Village, but there's nothing village-like about what they're doing to it. So they're sort of, while they're like selling it on those credentials, they're actually like taking it away with every day and every week.
I've got the knife. Look at it. You have the scar. I should have stitched. Now feel the love. Cut so quick. My open wound. The blood runs thick. But you look good.
This was the old bagel factory, Mr. Bagels, and it's going to be like a lot of these developments. They call it after what was something in the area. So really, obviously, this is called the bagel factory. It just says it all, doesn't it? Wick is land. You know that. Wick is land. Wick is people, actually, but we seem to get ignored by these people.
Myself, I was born here in the UK, and I grew up in London, East London exactly, actually Hackney. I grew up in Hackney, grew up throughout the 80s, 90s, so yeah, Hackney's where I was raised. Started a primary school called Gainsborough, which is up the road from where we currently are at the moment. Didn't last very long in there. I wouldn't say I was a troubled kid, I would just say I was a kid just excited and stuff. So I discovered Hackney Wick from a very young age. I'm going to be biased because I'm from here, so I'm always going to be biased about Hackney Wick. But what's special about Hackney Wick? I have to say the creativity, the creative space. Now this is something new which has been born of late, and I guess it's been born because of what's been happening around here. Now if you're familiar and aware with what's been happening in certain areas of London, then you will be familiar with a term called gentrification. You get what I'm saying? That's what's been happening around here. And in some ways, it's been a good thing. So creativity, it's brought it to a certain central point in Hackney. And Hackney Wick is that central hub, bursting full of creative individuals. In this building, you have a radio station, you have artists, I mean canvas artists, you have recording studios, you can come and record some music, rap, sing, you have dance studios, you have rehearsal studios, there's somewhere you can climb, there's across the road somewhere for vegetarians to eat, there's places for you to party. I cannot stipulate how amazing it is to be a part of this Hackney Wick venture. Because that's what it is at the moment. It's a venture. It's still fighting. Still fighting. Don't get it twisted. We're still fighting. But we're gonna fight. We're gonna persevere. That's what's gonna happen. Hackney Wick's great. It's great right now.
We want to be involved within this. Yeah. You know, this is our area. You need to come and try and understand this area and understand the people, the mix of people. You know, the different tasks and jobs we've done. You've got a room full of people with super brains and super skills, and you're treating us like we just thickos or something like
but
that.
But it's also
we
goes
are.
Back to the
one
LGC.
One second. You could involve us in all this, all these developments. We don't know what's going on. It just happens. Oh, there's the plans. Blah 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 blah. What about actually trying to involve us in the actual planning of all this sort of stuff? You might end up with a better development. You might end up, you know, people might look at you from all around the world and say, Telford Homes actually have done something. They're not just like some multi-million pound company that are doing this, doing that and ticking boxes. Because that's the perception of most developers in London and around the world, from Brooklyn to Ann Arbor to here, you know, probably end up in Wujja in Poland in about 3 years' time or something like that. You know, you could do this. That's what I want to convey to your boss, you know, and all these people in the room probably want to convey that too. You know, actually be an example, you know. We won't hate you as much. We won't be suspicious of you. You know,
and people will work with you. That's one of the brilliant things about Hackney Wick. There's an amazing spirit here. And
Hackney Wick is a building site full of construction companies. It must be the largest building site in Europe. I mean, populated with hard hats and high visibility jackets and scaffold towers and cranes. It's incredibly, it's an insane place, but it's always been a little bit quirky. And it just keeps getting more and more insane. It's very hard to explain the magnitude of what's going on and the love and life that this place holds within it. The gentrification is starting to happen. And I believe the life and soul is sort of seeping maybe away as the new polished buildings come in. It's going to be more generic, less spontaneous, less life. It's going to be no community, I believe. It's going to be each person for themselves in their nice flat, not taking part in the world around them. But I think there's a way of developing things, and it doesn't have to be the way it's being done now. There's a big gap between communications and, lack of respect, and it could be a beautiful thing. Developing together, working together, embracing the community here, making sure they still fit with the new plans, you know. Let's make this happen, you know. So I feel things could be being done in a much better way, but I feel that my time is pretty soon come and I'll be moving on. Yeah, I don't want to be here when all the luxury stuff's going on. To me, that's not real at all. So this site was known as Darrow, and it housed around 200 artists and studios. Well, less studios, but more. Around 200 artists inhabited this site. And when their time came, there was no implemented strategy for where they might go to next. And it begs the question, whose job is it to care about the culture and creativity of London, you know, and the country, you know? And I think people have been trading off this, this sort of soundbite that Hackney Wick is the most densely populated artistic community in the world or in Europe, you know. And I think people, even developers, are probably still trading off this soundbite. And it kind of makes you ask, how much longer can you say this is the most densely populated artistic community in Europe? Because, 200 just left, you know. And many others have left as well.
So they knew about the toxic waste way back then, because their cyanide was being released.
Well, they did the soil samples in this yard right here, and there's a big pole, and you know, and they've done them opposite there.
Yeah.
For these three warehouses now. So I mean, this begs the question: is this soil with these three matching warehouses, one with Thierry Noir painting on it? They've done soil samples there. Is it the same earth? I mean, I think this whole area is contaminated. And if so, can they carry on?
I swear to authority who can make a decision. What's
no,
the
exactly. When I stood here and a 50-foot spray came over here and they said it was water. It was not water. There was a rainbow in the air and there was thick droplets and they were running around like, ooh, ooh, ooh. It hit over here. Yeah.
Chemicals.
Of oil.
Exactly. For 100 years, you know.
Exactly. And so the history of the site, petroleum, chemicals,
chromium factory.
Did they have health and safety 200 years ago? No. So each building has dumped their crap and then another place has come and then they're just excavating it and it's dumping and dumping and dumping. And now they're exposing it. So, oh God, I hate being on camera.
every place has got its own little name, like homework or something, and little hashtag, do your homework, you know. And so, I mean...
A friend of mine, when I was in university, lived in the Wick. This is around 10 years ago. And I remember coming up and I saw the warehouses, I saw the graffiti, and the beat on the street, the art, not just artists, but it was musicians. They were just doing anything creative. The categories had gone. I think where I was living in Bethnal Green, it was very media creative. I'm more of a conceptual, visual kind of artist creative. So I just really loved the scene here. And I was like, I need to get a place there. It was hard to get a place here, actually. Because this was like derelict land and taxi drivers wouldn't stop here. A lot of gangsters used to like bury the bodies here or any kind of robberies. And they would have come here because nobody wanted to be here. It was cheap. You can live in a warehouse kind of space. There are pros and cons with that. In the winter, it's freezing because we don't have insulation and we get flooded a lot with the rain. And in the summer, it's boiling. But a little bit like if you think of New York when they were living in the warehouse part there, nobody wanted to be here. And then you had a lot of gypsies around the Olympic time. So it just wasn't artists. It was a mix of gypsies, gangsters. There was, I remember, I've heard stories about the pub de Lord Napier. A lot of crime went on here. It was a lot rougher when I first moved here 6.5 years ago. It has changed a lot. It's a weird one, Hackney Wick, because I think it's built up of three neighbourhoods. You've got the creative neighbourhood, and then if you go around the corner to where the kebab shop is, you've got the Trowbridge Estate, which is lots of social housing. I've been in talks, there's around 2,000-3,000 people live on that estate. So that must build up a lot of Hackney Wick. And then now with the gentrification, with the new flats, that'll be the third part of Hackney Wick.
This was a pub called the Lord Napier. Back in the day, in the old photographs, you can see that it served the kind of industrial community and stuff like that, and the residential community. Subsequently closed and then became, you know, a party kind of venue and stuff like that, probably squatted and things. It's kind of been derelict for ages, and you know, the slogan has become it's become a slogan, the shithouse to penthouse thing. It's even used by people who are building the new builds as a kind of like cool kind of thing, you know, come and live here where it's really funky and cool and people write shit on the wall, you know, and then you know, it's only going to cost you £500,000, you know, starter price or whatever, you know, usual stuff. But it's the whole pub's been decorated by street artists and random artists, and you know,
have a little look around, someone's climbing in to the ring. Someone is climbing in! Oh! They're climbing into the ground! They're climbing into the rain!
There is nothing wrong with development. There's nothing wrong with investment. But scattering the networks in place Hackney Wick is about very core geoflacy architecture and short-term planning. There is an issue with usurpation and cultural vandalism. Investors need to pay their dues. Speculation cannibalizes community achievements of established networks and uproots those who created value in the first place. We artificially implant corporate structures that sanitize and destroy the existing growth, and this is really short-sighted. And so is the destruction of spaces like Hackney Wick, creating a huge cultural vulnerability.
Is a very dear place to me because when I was younger, this was my raving capital. Like, this is the place where white people never used to come to. They never used to come here unless they lived here. That was it. It was a no-go area. Same for Brixton, same for Lambeth. When there was a lot of black people just didn't go. They were scared. They were scared to go. Hackney, nah, we're not going to. I can't rave with you. Like, that's just the reality of it.
And they are literally cleansing people. Getting rid of all people who don't have and building housing for people who do have. And, you know, like others have said, you know, losing vibe, losing culture, losing all those connections of people. Community with the little C came in. Community with the money came in. All right, we saved buildings from being obliterated, and little community came in with their millions. All right, and you know, negotiated with the local authority that they would lease the building and look after it. All right, and little community, little C, alright, are now trying to eradicate and erase community. And you know what? We aren't standing for that. Alright?
Show the change that we want to see. I mean, I think if we don't start doing the organising that we want to see, then the government and the state or any other players won't just give it to us. It's like anything else in life. You really have to say what you want and just demonstrate how you do it in order to make that change. And I think, especially given how bad the crisis is right now, that I think if we don't self-organize, that we will all lose hope that things will ever be different. And actually, I think there are examples all over the world of self-organized projects living situations, businesses and all kinds of other things that show that self-organizing can produce the society that we want to see. And the more we do it, the more people will see examples and get inspiration. And so I think it's one way is just keeping hope that things will get better, and the other is showing people and showing the other state and other players, other capitalist players, what really can be achieved and how good society can be if we have these kind of self-organizing, these kind of projects.
Can you speak to the people, and everyone, to the people here?
I think people really need to step up to the plate and start to make the change themselves.
Hackney Wick is the weirdest and the most wonderful place I've encountered in my life. I think most of the people here have a love-hate relationship with it. It's just a strange beast that taught me so much about people, about myself. And if I was to sell it, I would say that it's the strangest place on earth. Strangest place on earth. And it kind of, you know, when people tell you, you know, if you're traveling and you're learning about cultures and you should travel because you just learn and it's good for you, people say that it, like, I think that it helps your intelligence to see other cultures. It makes you more open and more human and just a nicer person. I think that the same with Hackney Wick. If you come here, you will see things that you won't see anywhere else, and it can teach you a lot about people. Even looking at the graffiti and how it changes taught me so much. It sounds a bit strange, but there's a really strange culture and subculture and underground culture here, and just being here and seeing how kind of people react over different things, it's just a really interesting experience.
So Hackney Wick is still a really creative area. There's still loads going on here, and there's still a really tight community spirit. Particularly with everything going on, people are coming together. They're working on trying to make the area stay creative, stay interesting, stay weird. The downside is, though, that it's hard, it's difficult, it's an uphill battle. People are being moved out, the prices are going up, and to be honest, most artists can't afford to stay here.
The area was an industrial area. This printing was big here, packaging, you know, like cleaning products and stuff like that. There's loads of different business, small engineering services, garages, you know,
That's the indigenous industry of this place. And the artists came in and colonised it, and the people who organise music parties and stuff like that came and colonised it. And the usual story is that that's used, you know, they're just kind of pawns in the kind of gentrification game, you know. They're allowed to kind of keep going for a while, and then they hope they'll go away quietly and stuff like that. But kind of we're at the point where, you know, we want something more permanent. We actually want the legacy that the LLDC, you know, London Legacy Development Corporation, has promised, and it's not being delivered. You know, there is, the legacy is not to give us a few hundred quid for doing a bit of graffiti and then say bye. It's like to actually provide some kind of long-lasting place where we can work, which is affordable, and I don't mean affordable by the government standard affordable, because that's a fake kind of affordability. We want proper partnership with the community, because we're already doing that. We want somewhere to live where we can actually be in the area. We'd have to live out of the area and come back as some kind of service industry from the suburbs or another town to kind of provide the kind of community interaction and services that a lot of us provide. And it's not been, the legacy is not there, it's not being put in place. And this is what we're angry about. And to be honest, I think Hackney Wick is the point where there's nowhere else to go. It's a sharp edge, where there's a canal there, there's an Olympic Park, and all the new developments staring us in the face of what this is going to turn into. And we're on the edge of it. And because we've got nowhere to go, because we're in a corner, we're fighting.
Jay has been working outside underneath the A12 bridge in Hackney Wick for a couple of years now. He uses it as a space to create his artwork and display it for the public's enjoyment and stimulation. And now he's being threatened with eviction.
This is very much a symbolic space for creative freedom. And so the fight that they're having with the council, it transcends just this area, and it speaks for also what's happening in Hackney Wick and London in general.
My name is Ben Wakeling. Wakeling. Ugh.
That's good.
Perfect. There's a part of my practice where I work as an artist for the NHS mental health. Specifically the forensics division, and with CAMHS, which is Child and Adolescent Mental Health. And I have set up a studio inside the hospital and something called a therapy wall, which is currently being researched by the University of East London. And I get to paint with some amazing individuals. And it's with the support of from creative organisations in Hackney Wick that has allowed us to maintain providing this intervention, this inclusive community group for people 2 hours a week to come over and to hopefully find some therapeutic or well-being parts in their day, really. I think London can be really difficult, so providing these well-being spaces and support networks, hopefully people see it as a good thing. We're trying to make it a good thing. This evolution that we're now seeing the final stages of is, perhaps in layman's terms, it's gentrification or regeneration, as some people would call it. And it's, in my lifetime here, it's gone from a very free-spirited, open invite, very inclusive part of the world, environment, a community, and it's given a space for grassroots people to learn and develop their practices. The evolution from what I've seen and experienced has been a place, a community where everyone's invited. It's a very inclusive community for creatives, for like-minded individuals. And that's evolved into developers, I think, seizing the opportunity from a lot of hard work, from a lot of beautiful individuals, and seeing their workplaces and homes ripped away from them. If I'm being brutally honest, I think it's evolved into quite a, or will end up evolving into quite a cold Westfield, really. And yeah.
What's your name? Your name? My name, Peter.
My name, Peter?
Yeah, Peter, yeah, my name. What's yours? You understand?
Bulgarian.
Yeah, what's your name?
Martin.
Martin, that was hard work. All right, Peter.
Bulgarian?
Yeah, your name is Martin. Martin.
Martin.
I'm Pete.
I'm Pete.
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 Peter, yeah.
Peter.
Yeah. Martin, Peter, Carlos.
Carlos.
Okay, Carlos.
Okay.
Peter.
Martin.
Okay. Yeah. Cheers, all.
My name is Felicity Jones, but I'm also known as Flea. It's my nickname for for many, many years, yeah. I traditionally trained as a blacksmith, like very old techniques, because I was sort of interested in sculpture, but I also make functional things and fix things, but I suppose I make a range of creative things like gates, railings, fire bowls, but I also do a lot of kind of quite big sculpture. I remember the first time I came to Hackney Wick, I was squatting in sort of Clapton or something. Our friends were squatting the Lord Napier, and this was probably, I don't know, like 2000 or something. And Hackney Wick was not like this. It was like full of prostitutes and it was quite scary. And I remember getting off the bus because they were doing a show about people that had been killed in Stoke Newington police station. So it was a talk and film about this. So it was in the pub. So I got off the bus, like, where am I? And sort of just walked through, and it was quite scary, and there was nothing here. And that was the first time I came to Hackney Wick. And it was a bit of a, like, desolate wasteland, I'd say. Yeah, not like this now. I suppose as time went by, kind of, and squatting got hard and stuff, I knew a lot of friends who kind of started renting warehouses here and sort of living quite cheaply. Mainly they were creative people and stuff. I had lots of friends that lived around here. I actually, my first boat, I used to moor up around here behind White Post Lane, and literally there was about two boats in the whole of Hackney Wick, like, and now there must be hundreds. And so, yeah, I mean, it was cool. Then there was quite a creative hub. There wasn't much, there was no bars here, there was like just the shop, and you know, you couldn't get much. And then I suppose slowly more people kind of came here, and then small little things used to happen, and yeah, there was lots of kind of social stuff. More shops started opening, but then I think it really changed when the Olympics came. And that, yeah, they kind of knocked down everything over the river, and lots more people started moving here, I suppose. And yeah, since then it's just gone crazy. Like on the river, there's just loads of boats, there's bars opened up. It's kind of loads of Essex people come here for this weekend out. And see all these buildings going up, and there's one happening just over there. But the thing about here, well, I suppose a lot of them have gone up, but they're not occupied yet. And when you read it, it's saying that they're meant to be affordable housing, and you have to be earning £80,000 as a couple to be affordable, which I don't really see a lot of people doing. And I think, you know, with Brexit and with just the kind of global current state of affairs, people haven't got money, so I really don't see who these people that are going to be able to afford to live in these places are, and whether they will fill up, because apparently they're not. And I know around here they're trying to make new developments, and because this area has always been really industrial, they're digging just over there. And basically there was like, everyone was complaining because the smell coming out of the ground was so bad. All the kids that are in the school over there, they had to get sent home, and so they did a toxicity report, and it was like the second worst polluted site they'd ever recorded, so they had to stop digging so deep because it just stunk and it was giving everyone headaches. So I don't know whether it can kind of continue on such a extent because it's not environmentally viable. You know, I know they want to knock down this yard at some point, but if it's going to cost them millions to do so, then maybe that's not going to be possible, so we might be able to stay. It's kind of nice that there's like more people around and stuff happening, but I think if a different type of person comes and they don't want the graffiti and they don't want this, then it would be a real shame to lose that. But then maybe that is the appeal, and maybe that's what they're trying to carry on to attract these people. But then, I don't know, generally happens in the circle of these things is that they kind of get the area trendy because of us, then they push us out, and then they have a kind of fake arty thing going on which isn't actually real, and it's just sort of to keep these people happy, so it's like a safe little kind of artist environment when it's not really. Well, I think it's something that's, you know, happening everywhere. It's happened in Berlin, it's happening in Barcelona, I don't think it's a London thing. But I mean, I think having a strong sense of community is good, and having ties between us so we can, you know, like when the building site was letting off loads of toxic waste, everyone complained, they held a public meeting and they had to stop it. And it's getting all sorts of people involved, because like, it's not just about the artists who can be a bit of a, you know, sort of a separate group. It's about, you know, the kids that live around here, the families, the people on the estates. It's about everyone kind of unifying, I think, to stop things happening. But I mean, you know, it's a bigger question. It's like, how do you stop this completely insane capitalist beast that's just chucking, you know, like has no care for poor people and what they can do, but doesn't see their value. So, I mean, yeah, I think strong community and communication between people, all different types of people, is probably the only kind of foot you got to stand on, really, isn't it? So.
Bob the Builder's gentrification circle must be broken. Communities need to take steps toward purchasing the land and spaces where they have taken root from an early stage to create strong negotiating positions.
I mean, they're all studios, like, where people work and reside and stuff like that.
The objective is to develop and protect the support networks that allow creators to focus on their work, see their way through the struggle of their early careers, and form the basis of a meaningful cultural industry. The value we generate must be ours to keep.
I think for me, being in a studio here in Style Space, having affordable space for artists to work has been a real lifesaver. And my concern is that the studio spaces are being, literally knocked down, and the new ones might be less affordable. So it's the real loss of creative workspace that is, it's really sad to see. I work with paper. I make things like origami, birds. Just did the job this year for making a thousand of these little shoes for a client, and other things like shop windows, paper flowers. I've made lots of this week. So yeah, always fun things with paper. I think, the really important thing about a place like Hackney Wick is this community, and I've not had that before, and I've been here for 6 years, and if it wasn't for Hackney Wick, I certainly wouldn't be able to do the kind of work I'm doing, and it's been really invaluable, and the friends and the community is really important.
So this was the communication centre or something of the Olympic Park when they built the Olympic development, and they've turned it into this place called Here East, which, you know, they've got, you know, businesses to kind of move in, you know, like they have in the East Village over there, sort of rebrands of kind of things that grew up in Dalston and stuff like that, and they've encouraged them, enticed them to come here as a kind of a startup or something, or a new franchise of their business, and the rest of it is kind of it's supposed to be like inhabited by, I guess, tech people and arts and stuff like that. And, you know, I mean, the vision for the area is basically something like that, isn't it, which is a rather ugly looking retail barn, kind of tartered up to look like, pimped up to look like some sort of art kind of centre. And, you know, I don't think that spaces like this have the same kind of heritage or community value as all these kind of second use or third use industrial spaces that have been turned into bars and artist studios and things. And the studios are certainly, you know, if they fall in under the affordable bracket, it's the kind of government definition of affordable, which everyone knows isn't affordable. You know, they just kind of shrug their shoulders and say, well, that's the law and we're within it, and those are the rules. But they're not, are they? And they're going to attract a different kind of business, you know. I mean, you can't knock any business for trying to set something up, you know, how difficult it is to set up a restaurant or a start-up of any kind, but the fact that the vision for Hackney Wick seems to be something like this is, you know, it's not a vision, is it? It's just a kind of a plan.
I came to Hackney Wick for the first time at the beginning of 2015, and for the first sight, I was already impressed with the amount of artwork in the streets, amount of graffiti, and slowly I started to go inside the neighborhood, into the bars and warehouses, and I start to meet people and see that this was a special place with a solid language, if I can say, of behavior, of street art, of community, of people knowing everybody, knew each other, kind of like a modern village, I would say, inside this urban, huge city that is London. I rather stay and resist, and I think now the change is already here. I can hear it now happening just next door. It already happened, and we need to find a way to interact with that, and whoever wants to stay, who doesn't want to stay can go. But now actually, especially who does street art or spray paint, that is my case, I will definitely have a different public to show. I think now is the best time, in my opinion, for street artists, because we are gonna be provoking, we can provoke, we can just talk, we can communicate with different people, and changes will be always happening. We're gonna go outside now to show you guys a bit. Yeah, it's not a bit, it's a lot. It's quite symbolic what's going on in our neighbor here, 41 Days Road. That shows a bit or a lot about these changes. I think this is part of this social cleansing. They want the neighborhood to look good, and they are destroying the soul of it.
I used to live in Homerton, which is very close. So I came here around, and there was like a cafe on Well Street where I used to live, and the guys who work there, they live in Hackney Wick and are a big part of the community here. So at one point, like, our lease ran out, and I was like, I want to live in a community and in a creative community. Also, that's the reason why I came to London. So I looked around in Hackney Wick, and then I found a warehouse to live and work in. And then, like, that's how I came here, and since then I never left. And whenever I'm here, I hardly ever leave the Wick. So it is a very good place to be for me, because it's there is no judgment. There's a very free vibe. It's very funny, because the first time I came here and went out, like, somebody told me, like, you know, if you're in Hackney Wick here, if you live in Hackney Wick, you gotta drop the tude. And I quite like it, because there is no attitude here. It's just a community, and everybody is quite respectful to each other when you live here, and friendly. The community is very strong. It is like we take care of each other. People are not just like living next doors, but people are interested in what other people do. And we are there. You can come alone or you can come and have friends already. But you come here, and if you make friends, you will be in that community, and it will take you on in a way that it's like I haven't experienced in any other city, or living in Vienna or in any other place, because there is a creative support, there is like people interested in what you do, there is serious conversations, there is arts and music happening. And it's not for the purpose of becoming famous or becoming like rich or any like, you know, pretenses normal people go for. It is just for the matter of being here and doing what you like to do. And that's what I like, because there is no judgment. You could go out play on your like kitchen pot, and it could be still something beautiful. So there's a really nice DIY approach to a lot of things that are happening here. Whereas then there is also like a very high artistic level approach, and there is such a big variety of people that are all really lovely. And to be honest, nobody gives a shit what's like what they do, as long as you stick together with the community. And this is what I have the feeling what we do here.
There's been a lot of change. There's the buildings, a lot of the artists have been pushed out, to be honest. And, you know, buildings are coming down, new buildings are being built. The community is definitely changing. It's not as, I'll say it, not as close-knit as it used to be. Not as, you know, artistic, not as creative. It's a lot, you know, it's just the way of the world, isn't it? It's gentrification. Just come in and it's kind of just taking seat, sucks the soul out of the community, really. That's my real take on like what's happening at Hackney Wick right now. And I think gentrification generally, anyway, at any level, it doesn't necessarily enhance, you know, the spirit of a place. It more takes away. You know. There's a few studios around there, like, you know, not like they're quite scattered around, but also, you know, you've got like artists of all kinds of from different walks of life. And yeah, it's pretty big. Like in my building, in my unit, there's probably about 15 studios, and everyone doing their own thing. There's like a fashion studio in the building as well, and the rest are like music studios. But everyone works in different, you know, parts of music. So that you got some are doing techno, you got some are doing grime, you got some are doing left field electronic hip hop, Afrobeat kind of stuff. Yeah, man, there's a lot. There's a lot of artists and diversity. Like, it's been my hub. You know, it's been a place where I've been able to grow as an artist, as a producer, as a person, as a human. And I've met so many people like being here, and built like some amazing, strong, long-lasting relationships here as well. But yeah, man. Like it's been a good 5 years. I tell you, yeah, definitely been a good 5 years. Yeah. It's sad to see, you know, Hackney Wick change the way it's changed, and like seeing it in my own eyes, you know, actually seeing it just calm down. Sometimes I sit down and I do reminisce and think, you know. It's mad. It's actually mad how quickly it's happened. It happened so fast. It's like there was one time when I came into my studio at the daytime, and I was here for did it all night. The next day I came out, and the building across the road was gone. But the day before I walked in, it was there. And you know, that's how quickly like things are changing, like before my eyes. And I think, you know, the government have their reasons, financial reasons, but you know, I'm someone who I live my life based on energies, you know, like being around good energies. And I think right now it's very, everything is a bit up and down with the soul of Hackney Wick right now, man. And you know, yeah, it's a sad state of affairs, but at the same time, there's not much one can do. You know, you just kind of have to ride the wave and, you know, hope for the best or work for the best. And yeah, that's what I've got to say.
I sent my love for butter and milk. I sent her for sweet wine. She returned to me empty-handed and gave me this reply. The cow she labours fruitlessly, the grape shrinks from the vine. It's a crime to ask for buttermilk, in these troubled times.
I don't know, I think there's a lack of, you know, and this is a general problem in London or any area that gets gentrified, there's a lack of kind of engagement with the people that are already there, that have been there a long time and, you know, to some degree have made that area interesting and viable. I mean, I think with this area, it's, you know, a lot of the development has happened as a result of the Olympics and, you know, that whole area being opened up and this kind of grand plan for this area of London. So that's been a big factor, but, you know, it's become an interesting area for people because, you know, there's a lot of creative people around here and there's, you know, interest in bars and there used to be a lot of free parties and raves and stuff like this and art spaces and what have you. So that's kind of one of the things that brought people into the area. And then when, you know, areas start to change, there's been very little consultation with those people, I think, and very little given back to them in terms of, you know, ways of being able to stay in the area if they want to or any kind of payoff, you know what I mean, you know, or any kind of anything really. It's just like all this is happening unless you own property, and even if you do, I think a lot of it's, you know, my understanding is being compulsory purchase, so you know, if you don't own property you're basically at the whims of what's happening. So consultation, I think, would be the main thing, and lack of an understanding of what the word affordable means as well. I think that's a big problem, because there's a lot of talk of affordable flats and affordable workspace and affordable studio space, and then you look at the prices that they call affordable and you think, how is that affordable? You know what I mean? It's just not, you know, for people that have lived in this area a long time and know what affordable used to mean, you know. Thank you.
We can go through. Press it, don't worry. Yeah, you can press it. Put it
oh, thanks. Yes, like.
Is your stomach better?
I'm using a lot of equipment, digital film, so I'm not like a fascist in terms of like film or digital. I'm using what I really need at the time, but I have a few very favorite cameras, and one is a Graflex. It's a 4x5 camera with this super nice Planaro Xenotara lens. And it's a camera you kind of load from the back and you look through or through the viewfinder, and you can it's large format, but you can easily fold it to kind of small package, so it's actually really really convenient travel size. Yes, like that, and I can go for a trip like that easy. Or I have a different one which is more like a studio work or studio camera, and it's a Linhof color camera, Cardan, which I use for shooting interiors. I have a wide angle lens and it's a similar, you load it from here, you look on that screen and you see everything upside down and horizontally flipped as well. Yeah. And with a friend of mine, we are having a dark room, so we can develop everything by ourselves. So from developing, scanning, editing, we do here in one place in Hackney Wick, which is super cool.
You need a help?
No.
Maybe I can switch the slide on. It's too gentle.
Usually what you do, I do this, so this is how it works, you know. Actually how I can focus. I can see you now.
All we do. Wickedest thing, I feel like I'm the wickedest thing. If we don't feel like you're the wickedest thing. See nothing when I say the wickedest thing. The wickedest.
My first memories of Hackney Wick would be Sunday Market, Powerhouse, aka Shinola's.
That's the wickedest.
Originally, I'm known as a grime MC. I was a part of a group called Roll Deep. Started back in 2001. Today I still do a little bit of music, but my main focus is artist management, and I have a record label called Rhythm Rollers.
I come true with the wickedest, you come true like a wallowist, straight R.I.P. when I put a man down.
So, music industry's male.
I don't know how I ended up, I can't remember how I ended up here, but I ended up here and it's a good place to be.
Why?
It's a good network of people, especially in this building. Everybody's really creative, we get along well, yeah, it's a good network of people. wheel and pull it up under this. Pull up that job, I can be a man of this. But yeah, man, it's changed a lot. It's changed a lot around here. I can't reckon. I still have to use a sat nav to travel around here. Before, I could walk it like blindly. But yeah, you need a sat nav now.
Anyways.
So, you know, if you look at London and you look back through history, it's the vibrant communities that we value. And this is the community of this generation, and it needs to be preserved. So to try and eradicate that and allow it to me, it's like it's a resource and a value that needs to be protected in the same way as it's a natural resource needs to be protected. Because if you allow it to flow to other places around the world, it's your loss.
Areas like this are really important and becoming really rare, and for London particularly, you know, which we want, and like our politicians and our leaders and our, you know, public have always sort of like displayed a sense of pride in our creative and cultural leadership or whatever in the world. And those kind of cultural icons that they invite to the mayor's reception, and you know, those people that they sort of like talk about so proudly, most of them came originally in the 80s from places like this, warehouse communities and spaces where people can actually create and develop their art, develop their thoughts. And often, you know, you'll find there's an incredible mixture of disciplines, you know, so like thrust together in small spaces, you'll have 70 different people. That one might be a filmmaker, one might be an electronics genius, one might be working in like creative aspects to do with arts or music or food. And there's so many different people in a real creatively dense population that are all sort of like-minded and respectful of each other's approach, that what you end up getting is not only this natural sort of interbreeding, which really like means that you get a cross-pollination of artistic disciplines and like interesting like mixtures of like this person might be sat on a break speaking to this person and a new project is just born like that. And I think that's how art evolves rapidly. And outside of universities, you don't have dense collections of people, you know, working creatively. And even in universities, usually, you know, you'll have like the kind of structure and regime of a university, which is really important for educating people. But when people have like left that space, where do they go? And often in London, you'll have like isolated pockets and islands of studios where people can rent a studio, but you know, will essentially be working on their own and don't really have that support and community around them. And in areas like this, even like with the event that we're putting on tonight, what you've got is a lot of different people from this community working with also some other artists who aren't from this community that are global. But the people from this community are all sort of chipping in and lending each other equipment, lending each other time, expertise, and I think that's what they call a shared economy. And that's the kind of thing people who are in that developing stage need, you know, like, because, you know, they might not always have the great income that covers the cost. So, you know, if you're putting on an event, you need to hire this and hire a person who can do that and all these things. When people are lending each other that time, lending each other that sort of skill set and lending each other equipment, they're enabling each other to do things. And once those things are enabled, they actually are given a chance to get off the ground and sort of like begin to fly on their own. But if you don't have that at the developing stage for people in the early parts of their career, then you're stifling the channels that should exist for people to actually develop and grow their career and have a chance at turning it into something that's sustainable, let alone growing into something that might be culturally significant, not even just in this country, but occasionally globally. And that happens. I see that happening. So when we throttle places like this, when we disregard places like this as being too scruffy, or, you know, like people, you know, might sometimes just like look at things on face value and see graffitied buildings and, you know, like just think that it's somehow, you know, like got no tangible value attached. When we throttle things with that way of thinking, then we cut off something that's really important for our cultural generation. You know, it's really important. So yeah, thanks.
I would like to say to people in residents in Hackney Wick that I think we need to continue to come together and take solace with each other, keep talking, and keep working towards protecting our homes and businesses and our safe places. We've all got so much in common, and I think sometimes we can be bombarded with so much information, so much negativity. But as long as we continue to keep coming together and showing a united front, I think Hackney Wick can be protected, even though a lot of it's gone. But I think Hackney Wick can be protected, its soul, original soul, can be protected. Uniting is really important. We're all in it together.
Maybe for a year or two, but the virus, it crawled underneath my skin. Coming down with a white rose, I split the north and hit the road, when I heard the ghetto calling out my name. With my dog and my guitar, well, we could only go so far, for the three of us were running out of brass. But I had everything to gain with sweet F.A. to my bad name, asylum seeking less than sweet F.A. to lose. And now I'm back in the bosom of Mother Hackney, seen of all my crimes. But Mother Hackney, you've witnessed all the crimes against me. God knows I've served my time.
There's so much to say. Hi, Mum.
Cool.
Okay, cool.